People can see my screen, but I could see the how to camouflage this one, sir. The people, the participants thing I would see here.
So you are seeing the participant list, sir?
Right. Okay, sir. Now it's okay, sir. Now it's okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I have collapsed it.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yes, friends. Today we will be discussing this innovative pedagogical approaches. So once again, sir, let me. I will be using OneNote extensively, so let me check whether I can use that OneNote also or not. It's all participants. So now my my OneNote screen is visible, sir. Can you see my OneNote screen,
sir?
Yeah. Can you see my screen, sir?
No, sir. No. And, no.
This thing I am not seeing here. Okay, can I share? One second. So this screen, can you see it, sir? This screen?
Yes, yes, sir. Now NRI. we can see. Okay. Okay.
This NRIIT OneNote screen, you can see that one, but PowerPoint will not be able to see now. This, so let me, this PowerPoint is also visible now, sir?
Yes, sir. Now it is. Now it is visible, sir.
Okay, okay. So now, okay. Now let me start my session. So friends, today morning we will be discussing this innovative pedagogical approaches. So what I will be doing here is. So I will take the session in this methodology, and first one is we will see that the entire country is moving towards outcome-based education. So we'll have a brief, like say, 5 minutes discussion towards outcome-based education, and then I will try to justify that the different types of methods that we will be discussing in today's session will be aligned towards this outcome-based education. So we need to realize the importance of outcome-based education. And while realizing that one, while discussing this OBE introduction component, we will also be discussing the different types of learners. Okay, the types of learners will also be discussed. Okay, because this is very vital for today's scenario, because we have a different set of learners sitting before us in the classroom. So we'll discuss this different types of learners. Hello, I request somebody has unmuted them or mute themselves. Okay. So we will discuss these types of learners, and after that we will move on to this innovative pedagogical methods or approaches. So this is how we will be discussing. So these are the three prominent areas that we will be touching upon in this 1.5 hours presentation. So let me move on to this presentation. Okay, now before moving on to this presentation, so let me put the disclaimer statement. So the views in this presentation are my own, and it does not represent the entity, the opinions of the entity to which I belong. I also place on records my sincere thanks and due acknowledgements to the NBA authorities and to the research scholars and the eminent researchers' outputs and outcomes that I have used in this presentation. The whose photographs have been used are also extensively thanked, are also profusely thanked at this juncture. And last but not the least, this presentation is exclusively meant for educational purpose and not for any commercial thing. So friends, let us go to the first component, that is outcome-based education. So I will not be spending much time towards it, and you should be naively pinpointing a small case study here. So we all know that this Washington Accord was initiated in 1989 and India became a signatory in 2014 and so on. Those things are known to us. But in 2019, COI authorities, they wanted to invalidate the IIT degrees because the degree holders of IITs, their degrees were not approved by the competent authorities or by the NBA authorities. Following which, many IIT degree holders or many IITians were about to lose their job. So the timely intervention of Ministry of Higher Human Resource Development helped the IIT graduates to retain their positions, and they were able to stick on to their same position where they were. So now you could realize that one could realize the importance of accreditation, the importance of MBA, because only when we get accredited, our degrees will be in par with the degrees offered by other prominent institutes, and the graduates of our institution will not be having any kind of trouble in future. So for getting accreditation, we know that the MBA strictly follows outcome-based education. And this outcome-based education, we would like to clarify that this outcome-based education is not the same traditional method of education, but rather it is a kind of education where it is mostly focusing towards the outcome component. So now let us see why this outcome-based education has come into picture. So for that one, we need to compare two eras. One is your industrial era, and the other one is your information era. So the industrial age, the process was very, very simple, and where the students are, even in the industries, the process was very simple. In the classroom scenarios also, the process was very simple, and the people were made to learn the contents, and after getting graduated from a particular institution, they will move on to a job, and they will remain in the job for almost 30 years or 25 years. And in the process of doing the monotonous work, they will be facing job boredom and other things. So many techniques were infused in the industries to make the employees really enjoy their work. But the current scenario is not like that, because both in the industrial scenario as well as in the classroom scenario, the process has become very complex. So our teachers, they should be in a position to realize that let us assume that if a teacher is going to retire by 2015, that teacher may not be knowing the nuances of this online teaching techniques. But a teacher who is about to retire by 2024 or 2025, he or she is supposed to learn these kind of techniques, and using these tools, digital tools, the teacher should be able to carry out the teaching learning process effectively. And they will be using the digital tools for teaching their subject. This one we know. So now you could see the same teaching process has become complex, but in the olden days it was more or less simple, except the PowerPoint and other presentations we were using. But now we are making use of these complex technologies for our classroom instruction purpose. The same thing is happening in almost all workplace scenarios. So the entire workplace scenario has become very complex because of this information age. Okay, because we are always flooded with so many information. Second one is, in the case of industrial age, we have to move towards, we were focusing on this specific learning. Okay, so when a person is about to undergo a kind of specialization, we will see that whether there is any kind of connectivity between the current degree and the previous degree. So it is more or less a narrowed approach, and a specific learning was emphasized during this industrial age. But now in the information age, the specific approach has become obsolete. It has become more or less continuous and connected. So you will be learning specific things in a subject. Similarly, you will be learning, a student will be learning specific things in some other subject, and the student should be able to meaningfully establish the connectivity between the specifics that he has handled, okay, that he or she has learned, okay, that he or she has learned in the previous semester. So it is always continuous learning is happening in the information age, and connected learning should also happen in an information age. That is why one of your program outcome, which is derived from the graduate attribute, that is a lifelong learning, has been infused in this outcome based education. And the third one is, okay, so in the industrial age, in the classroom scenario, people were having a simple philosophy that everybody cannot learn, because the learning was very specific. So when a student cannot learn that specificity within a stipulated time, then the people who are unable to master that specific learning, people were branded, those people were branded as the non-learners, are people who are unable to complete a degree, or they will be given a different kind of branding and so on. But in the case of information age, we have a simple philosophy that the same philosophy got renamed because of this complexity involved, and we know that everybody can learn and succeed in the outcome-based education, but not on the same day, because this continuous and connected learning is happening. So therefore, everybody will not be in a position to connect the different points, will not be in a position to reach the end destination on the same day. So you have a time flexibility in this information age. And last but not the least, when you compare this industrial age and information age, more emphasis was given to the process in the case of industrial age, whereas in the case of an information age, we give more emphasis to the product. Okay. So very recently, I will just tell you one of the case studies here. So we went in for an advertisement. So let me share it here. So the advertisement goes like this. So the thing is, okay, so kindly wait. So let me share my downloaded things. So let me search it. So I'm just sharing one of the advertisements made by NIEEE at Chennai. So I request somebody to unmute themselves and read this thing. Maybe somebody can unmute and read the first serial number. What is written here? I hope the screen is visible to you people. Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is visible, sir.
Yes, sir. Somebody can unmute and read the first class, 5.5, evidence of educational qualification. Participants, are you all there? Yes, sir. Somebody can unmute and
yes, sir.
Yes, madam. Please read this thing.
Yes, sir. Point.
Yes, madam. Can you see the screen? And just read it, madam.
Yes, sir.
Yes, madam. Candidate should be
evidence of educational qualifications. Candidate should be. Should have been obtained a degree UG / PG by a recognized university through full-time regular course.
Okay. The same thing. Kindly read the amended one, madam.
Amended to read as evidence of educational qualifications. Candidates should have obtained a degree UG / PG by a recognized university.
Okay. Thank you very much, madam. Now, participants,
welcome, sir. Welcome. It's a pleasure. Thank you.
So participants, you can see the previous case, before amendment, we were emphasizing a degree through full-time regular school. But now that ministry has advised us to go in for a recognized degree, and this full-time regular course has been removed. So this itself is a clear indication that the entire globe is moving towards product and not towards process. So this is your industrial age and information age comparison. So okay, friends, now when I am going for this industrial age and information age comparison, so why this information in this information age, we do have a specific set of learners. Okay, let us move on to the second one. So the first one is we have discussed the basics of outcome-based education. So the need for outcome-based education came into picture because everybody is living in an information era. And in an information era, continuous and connected learning are expected from the learners. So therefore, we are moving towards outcome-based education. Okay, when I have framed the outcomes, I have a set of learners who need to achieve those outcomes. Okay, I have a set of learners who need to achieve those outcomes. And who are these set of learners? So that one we have to look at. So friends, when you look at the classification of Mark Brensky, he has classified the learners into two categories. One set of learners are called as digital natives. The other set of learners are called as digital immigrants. Okay, right. So who are these digital natives and who are these digital immigrants? That's what we are going to see. And when I look at the digital natives and digital immigrants, every these set of people, the digital natives will be having certain set of characteristics, and the digital immigrants will be having a different set of characteristics. So let us assume that, in any country, after the internet has pervaded into their lives, okay, we brand those people who were born during this internet era as a digital natives, okay, or during this information era as digital natives, and people who were born before this internet boom and other things, or before this digital economy or digital things, or who were born in the analog era, they were all branded as digital immigrants. So colloquially, let us assume that, people who were born after 2000, for time being, let us assume that these people were branded as digital natives. And similarly, people who were born before 2000, okay, people who were born before 2000 or 1990s or something, then we can call those people as digital natives. I hope many of the participants in these training program, okay, are falling under, will be falling. Audio is not clear. So can you hear me, sir? My audio is clear. So many of the participants who are attending this training program will be coming under this digital immigrant category, and the students sitting before us may be branded as digital natives category. So first and the foremost thing is, like, the digital natives are known for their parallel processing. Okay, where the digital natives are known for their parallel processing. They were known for their multitasking. Okay, they are known for their multitasking. So kindly bear with my spelling mistake. Okay, right. So they are known for multitasking. But digital immigrants, they follow only a sequential approach. The digital immigrants, they follow a sequential approach. So that means we try to master one technology, and after in that mastering that technology only, we'll be moving on to the next technology or the next version of that technology. Okay. But these digital natives are so immersed in the technology, so they will be able to do things parallelly. So friends, the students sitting before us are known for their parallel processing, and the teacher standing before them is known for his or her sequential processing. That is one gap between the digital natives and digital immigrants. Second one is, when I look at this digital natives, these people are so immersed in technology, and so therefore they welcome new technology. When I'm so immersed in this technology, I will be having some kind of, let us say, I'll be able to find out some lacuna or flaw in the technology. So I want that flaw to be addressed. So therefore, I will be mailing the concerned authorities to rectify that flaw. So hence, a new version will be introduced. As a result, the digital natives will welcome new technology. On the other hand, the digital immigrants will always resist new technology. Let us say, as a digital immigrant in the initial time, okay, before the start of this program, I was having some kind of issues from my end, because I was not comfortable using GoToMeeting. All these days we have been using only Google Meet and TeamViewer, Microsoft Teams, but this is the first time I'm using this GoToMeeting. Somehow or other I'm able to cope up with this. Okay, so the digital, but this kind of issues the digital natives, even if they face, they will be able to overcome that one at least, because they are so immersed in technology. And the most important thing is the digital natives have less patience. And one of the promising feature of the digital immigrant is, we are known for our patience. The thing is, like, we have been standing in queues, we have stood in the bank queues, we have stood in the railway station queues for booking tickets and other things. But for these digital natives, these people, for each and everything, they do things at by sitting at their own place. They will not be moving out of their place because technology and internet is connecting them to different places, and they were able to do things at ease. Okay. So hence, let us assume that if you are giving a Pentium system to a digital native, that fellow will really break it. But we will wait. Okay. We have the patience. We will wait for the things to get uploaded, but the digital natives will not have that patience. Okay. And there was also a research conducted by Coursera, and this Coursera people has come out with some kind of predictions. So let me share the predictions here, and then you will come to know that how the classroom scenario will be from 2025 on. So here, this Coursera people, among these digital natives, this Coursera people, they have branded, they have bifurcated, or they have given a kind of classification for a new kind of classification for these digital natives, and those people are called as neo-digital natives. Okay, neo-digital natives. But who are these people? Who are these people? They say that the people who were born after are 2008, okay, 2008 to 2009. Why these people are branded as digital, neo-digital natives? The reason here is this was the time the smartphones got introduced. Okay, this was the time the smartphones got introduced. So the children who were born during the smartphone era, they are so versatile in the digital technology. They are so versatile with the technology, and they can handle anything at ease. They can handle anything at ease. And the most important thing is, these people who are born during 2008 or 2009 or after 2008 and 2009, right now they are in their school classroom. Okay, right now they are their school classrooms. In the sense, they might be either in the middle schools or they might be in the classroom. They might be in the primary schools. Okay, so these people might be attending the classes in the primary schools or in the secondary schools. And by 2025 to 2027, these people will be trying to will be entering the college classroom. So these people will be entering the college classroom. So when these people, when they come into college classrooms, their expectations will be entirely different. Their expectations will be entirely different, because when I look at one prominent feature of digital native is most of the things they will prefer visual mode. Okay. But the digital immigrant, we prefer auditory mode of learning. So when these people come into classroom scenario, when these people venture into college classrooms, right now they are being controlled by the class teachers. When they turn 17 or 18, they become adolescents. Okay, so it becomes, so we cannot control them using some kind of punishments, or we cannot control them. So you have to, they will be expecting some kind of liberty in the classroom. So the teacher standing before them has to adopt a different kind of teaching technology. Otherwise, the teacher's job will be perishing. Okay, the teacher's role will get vanished. In the sense, that particular teacher who is not adapting themselves to the changed classroom scenario, that kind of teaching style might perish from those classrooms. And moreover, this innovative pedagogical approaches will be always welcomed by these new digital natives as well as by digital natives. And the research finding of Coursera also says that these people, okay, these people will be having the basics, okay, the fundamental information, the fundamental information regarding any subject will always be available in any of the educational videos. Say, for example, they will get the fundamental things related to circuit theory, or fundamental things related to physics or chemistry or computer science or civil engineering or whatever it may be. Those fundamental things will be already available in YouTube or in Share Khan Academy or in the Coursera websites. So they will be always flooded with that kind of videos, so they can get that fundamental information from those videos. So the teacher's role gets revised by 2025 onwards. So when, as a teacher, when I go to a classroom, when I want to share the basics, okay, when I want to share the basics, of course the students will be welcoming me, but they will be welcoming me to share the basics, the doubts that they have regarding their fundamental component. So I will be always expected to share the doubts. The real fundamental components, they might get it from the educational videos or from the YouTube videos. Second one is the teacher's role gets changed here. How the teacher's roles get changed? The teacher's role will be more focusing towards the application component. In the sense, you want to make the students apply the fundamental components in the classroom in the real time scenario. Okay. So it gets drifted away from content-based learning to context-based learning. Okay. So in the outcome-based scenario also, in the traditional objective-based education system, we were more focused towards content-based learning. But in the outcome-based education system, we are more focused towards, okay, we will be more focusing towards this context-based scenario. And another one striking feature in the classroom that is going to happen is, by 2035 or so, these digital natives will become teachers. Okay, all these people will become teachers, and the students sitting before them are also digital natives. Now these digital natives, both the students will also have less patience, and the teacher will also have less patience. And they are predicting that every college should be having psychologists near future to address the behavioral issues of the teacher as well as the behavioral issues of the student. That is what they are predicting. But sometimes the predictions can go wrong also. Okay. So these things, these technological advances. Okay. Now these technological advances, whatever is happening, the technological advances are learned at ease by the digital natives. But as the digital immigrants, we need to fulfill the expectations of these digital natives. Okay. So this is how we try to classify learners. So friends, when I am going to a classroom scenario, let us assume that when I am conducting a training program by 2030 or 2035, so in that case, digital natives will be there before me. So the traditional teaching approach or the traditional training approach may not be welcomed by the digital natives, because they expect a different thing, a different kind of teaching methodology or instructional strategy from the teacher or from the trainer. So to cater to the digital natives' expectations, what are all the things, or what are all the kinds of innovative pedagogical methods that we are going to adopt, or that we are going to see, or that we are going to practice? So we are going to discuss on that. Second, that is the core component of this lecture. And before getting into this, I have given you the basic details pertaining to digital natives and digital immigrants. And when you look at the learners, research has been carried out extensively, and research says the learners are further classified into five major types. Okay, you can classify learners into according to five domains, or according to five types. Okay, five major categories you can classify learners. We will look at the learner classification. This learner classification may be appropriate or can be applicable for both digital immigrant as well as for digital native, as well as for digital natives, types of learners. This one we will discuss in detail. Okay. So when I look at the, if you look at the research work carried out by Felder and Silverman, okay, when you look at the research work carried out by Felder and Silverman, okay, so they have classified learners based on five categories. Okay, let me classify that one. So they have classified learners based on five major categories. One is, okay, the categories are, but the first and the foremost category is, so how the students or how the learners perceive the information, So based on perceptions you can classify learners. Second one is, based on the input, okay, how the students expect the input. from the teacher. So based on input also you can classify learner. And third one is how the students are going to organize this input. Okay, how the students are going to organize the information that they get. So based on that also you do have a different set of classification. And fourth one is how the student processes the information. Okay, how the student process the information within their mind. So based on that also you do have a different set of classification. And last but not the least, how the students understand the information, based on that you will be having a different set of classification. So these are the five major categories under which you can classify your learners. Okay, under which you can classify your learners. Now let us take the first one. So how the student perceives the information, how the student is going to perceive the information. So the first and the foremost thing is you have two different set of learners. One set of learners are called as sensory learners. The other set of learners are called as intuitive learners. So friends, in your classroom, you could have a group of sensory learners and a group of intuitive learners. But let us assume that majority of your students are coming under this sensory learning category. They have a very specific kind of learning style. But on the other hand, when you have a set of students who are coming under this intuitive learning category, then we do have a different set of learning style. So what is that one here? So when I take these sensory learners, are more interested in learning facts. Okay, they're more interested in learning facts. So you present some factual information, they will be interested in learning facts. And most important thing is they are more interested in doing the same task repeatedly. They are doing the same task repeatedly. Okay, let us say you want the students to find the square root of a quadratic, the roots of a quadratic equation. Okay, roots of a quadratic equation. And you give some problem for different values of A, B, and C. If you give them 10 problems, the sensory learners will be meticulously solving those problems. But on the other hand, in the intuitive learners, when you go for this intuitive learners, okay, what kind of things they are, how do they perceive information? So here, what they do is, when you tell them some fact, okay, they will always question the fact. Okay, in the sense, the question will be arising within themselves. And as a teacher, we need to anticipate the questions and we have to give them the correct type of answer. When you have that kind of students, you should anticipate that kind of question. Okay, what kind of questions the students might ask? And you should always tell them. Second one is these students, they may not be interested in doing the tasks repeatedly. They will not do tasks repeatedly. Same kind of, because they know the logic. Okay, they know the logic. And therefore, they will get bored easily. These people will get bored easily. So depending upon the type of learners that you have before you, you need to modify your teaching strategy. Okay. So when you have a sensory learners, you can present the information as such. When you have an intuitive learner, you have to present the information differently. Because these people are not interested in doing the task repeatedly, and most important thing is they were always posting the task. Okay, right. That is number one. When I look at the input component of the Felder and Silverman learning style, it is mostly applicable for sensory learners, especially for the engineering classrooms and arts and science classrooms we can fit it. So when I go for this one, input style, so you see there are two types here. One is it is mostly applicable for sensory learners. Either you can classify the learners under visual category, or you can classify the learners under auditory, or you can classify the learners under auditory mode. Okay, the sensory learners, either they will prefer information visually, or the sensory learners will be preferring information auditory, through auditory mode. Or in some other cases, when I am going for catering institutions, where I am dealing with occasional trades and other things, there my kinesthetic approach also comes into picture. Okay, there my kinesthetic approach also comes into picture, where the student will be using the other senses. Okay, especially when I am teaching the catering students, the students have to look at the aroma and say that whether the dish has been cooked properly or not. Okay, whether the dish is burnt or the dish is at the right stage, so that you can switch off the stove. So that kind of senses will come into picture. So mostly in our classrooms, especially engineering classrooms, mathematics, science, and other science-related classrooms, we predominantly follow visual and auditory mode of learning. Okay, visual and auditory mode of learning. And the third one is, okay, when I go for this kind of organization, okay, how student organizes the information, you do have two different types of learners. You do have two different types of learners. One is you do have an inductive learner. One is you do have an inductive learner. The other one is you do have a deductive learner. The other one is you do have a deductive learner. Okay. So who is an inductive learner and who is a deductive learner? Okay, who is an inductive learner and who is a deductive learner? So that one we have to analyze right now. Okay. So before getting into this intricacies of inductive and deductive learners, let me ask a very basic question. Okay, by the human beings, what is the learning style of a human being, learning style of a of an infant? Okay, let me say an infant baby. Okay, so human being, let us say for an infant, what learning style the infant has, whether it follows inductive approach or the infant is going for deductive approach. The infant is going for deductive approach. So the options are inductive or deductive. Okay, now let me stop for a while, and I request the participants to unmute themselves and give me their answer. What is the learning style of an infant or a baby? Inductive or deductive? Yes, participants, you can unmute and then give me the answer. Or else, if you could let me see whether I am able to open a Google form and then pose the same thing to you. So let me create a Google form. So this is the Google form. So what is, okay, the question is, what is the learning style of an infant? One is, option one is inductive, option one is inductive, second one is, option one is, option two is deductive, option two is deductive. So let me share the link of it, and then let me paste it in the chat box. That will do. So let me see how I can post it into the chat window. Okay. So I want to post it. I hope. Can you see the, can you participants, can you see the link that I have shared in the chat window?
Yes, sir.
Yes, maybe you can start responding to that one. So let me hope, or let me wait for the responses. Okay, it is inductive. Google Form is not visible. Okay. So mostly, okay. Please post the link here. Why it is not going? Control C. So now is it visible? So I have shared the Google Form. I hope it is not working properly. Okay. No issues. Anyhow, I have got very many people have responded. Mostly, they have responded on the correct response.
Hello?
So we, yes, your friends, you know that the learning style of an infant is, the learning style of an infant is inductive. So what does it mean? It means whether the inductive, in inductive learning, we go from examples to rules. We go from examples to rules. Whereas in the case of deductive approach, we handle rules first and then we will move on to this example. Then we move on to this example. Okay. So we have two different learning styles. One is you have inductive approach, the other one is you do have deductive approach. In the inductive approach, the students will be willing to frame the rules. Let us assume that if the students are there before you and they mostly fall under inductive learning category. Okay, they mostly fall under this inductive learning category. So in that case, you need to share examples to the student, and from these examples, the student will be able to formulate a draft rule. Okay. But that is not being practiced in almost all the classes, because our textbooks and our other materials are being following deductive approach only. First, they tell you the rules, and for the tools to have a better understanding over the rules, we will be moving on to the examples component.
Oh,
so, the second one is we predominantly follow deductive teaching methodology, where we teach the rules first and then we will be moving on to this example. So, Patrick, somebody has to mute themselves. I request the organizers to mute the. Okay. So we do have inductive and deductive learning. So,
sir, one second, sir. I'll mute all. Yeah, I muted including you, sir. Please unmute yourself.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay. So now we have from examples to rules and then to rules to examples. Now, friends, you always keep in mind that when a child wants to garner the attention of the elders, the child starts making some noise or the child will be showing tantrum. So the child is not taught that when you are feeling hungry, you should cry or something like that. But the child, through the behavior, the child will be able to decode the thing that when I make a noise, somebody will be looking at me or somebody will be paying attention to me. So similarly, in a classroom, when examples are shared and when the students are made to frame the rules, then it will be a welcome approach for an inductive learner. For an inductive learner, when you are following deductive learning approach, then those learners may not be interested in sitting in your class. But the most, what I would say is, one of the major drawbacks of an inductive learning is, it is a time-consuming approach. So till the student is able to formulate a rule, or till the student is able to understand the concept behind the examples, then the student, till that time, the speaker has to tell the student. It's mostly time consuming. But when we follow this inductive learning, it will help the students to connect the dots. It will be helping the students to connect the dots, because from the various examples that I am sharing here, the students will be able to identify from these examples, okay, this is the common point, so therefore they will come to that point. Therefore they will come to that point here. Okay, so this is one striking feature of inductive learning. So you need to first, you need to think, or you need to analyze your student's learning style, and then only you have to adopt the particular kind of teaching instructional strategy that is going to benefit the students at large. Right. So let me go on to the next kind of students. One is your process. So based on your process, you do have different set of students. One is, one students are known for active processing, the other students are known for their reflective process. The students are known for their reflective process. So who is an active learner and who is a reflective learner? Who is a reflective learner? So when I take this active learning, so in friends, if you see, let us assume that you have a set of learners and you want the students to solve some issue, or you give a task to the student community. So you divide the students into so many tasks, you divide the students into so many groups, and you want the students to solve the task using some set of rules, okay. These active learners will be trying to solve that problem using the rules, okay, using the rules. Okay, the active learners will be trying to solve the problem using the rules, okay. And after that, you will cross-check the answer with the correct answer that you have already worked out, okay. So these active learners will be more interested in executing the rules, will be more interested in executing the rules. So this is what is happening in a active learning, and this is what is happening with active learning. Or in other words, I can say they will execute the rules. They will execute the rules. Okay, fine. Second one is, when I compare these reflective learners, these reflective learners are much more ahead of these active learners. So when we ask these people to solve a problem using the rule, the first and the foremost thing is they will reflect on the rule itself and they will question the rule. So they will always have a question that, why I should solve this problem using this? What is wrong in approaching the problem in a different way? So whether it is wrong or right, so they will question it. So they will reflect on the rules itself. They will reflect on the facts itself. So that kind of learners are always called as reflective learners. So let us assume that you are going to teach alphabet. So this one, I am just telling you a case study that an English teacher has shared with me. So the teacher told that she had a different experience with a set of classrooms, with the different classrooms and with a different set of students. In one case, if she, especially this happened at the school level, in one classroom, the teacher was teaching alphabet. So the teacher was telling there are 26 alphabets and you have to write this thing like A, comma, B, comma, like that it goes and it goes up to Z. Okay. So the teacher was teaching this thing. And mostly when the active learners are there, the active learners were simply following this 26 things. They were writing A, B, C and like this. Okay. But she happened to come across few learners whom she branded as reflexive learners, because they were questioning the teacher that why this is not written as A and why this is written as A and why this is written as A. Why can't this thing be called as A and why this alone should be called as A? And they were trying to find an answer within themselves, but they were unable to find an answer. So therefore, they asked this question to the teacher, this teacher. So this teacher also did not have an answer. So she has to work upon it, and she was, and after getting the relevant information, okay, after getting the relevant information, the relevant information, then the teacher was able to give the correct answer. The teacher was able to give the correct answer. Sense, we know that English language is called the language of borrowing. Okay, so when you look at Greek, okay, when you look at Greek, in Greek, number one is this number one is U. So that is why your alphabet, you have this alpha. Okay, this is your number one in Greek. So therefore, you have, it is starting with A, and your small A is written like this. It is nothing but your alpha. this kind of reflective learners. So you have reflective learners sitting before you, and these reflective learners will always question the rules, will always question your rules. So when you have a majority of learners who are coming under this reflective category, then our teaching strategy has to be different. Okay, then our teaching strategy has to be different, which will be pondered upon and it will be discussed in due course of time. So okay, now last but not the least, based on the understanding level of the learners, you do have different types, two types of learners are there. One is you have sequential learners. Okay, you have sequential learners. The other one is we'll be having global learners. Other one we'll be having global learners. So who is a sequential learner? When a sequential learner is sitting before you, okay, sequential learner is sitting before you, this kind of learner will always expect information to be given to them, and that information, pieces of information should be related. Pieces of information should be related to each other. Pieces of information should be related to each other. Okay, related pieces of information should be given. Let us say I give a point one, and after that I move on to kind of information with part two. So that should be a meaningful connection between this one and the two. Otherwise, the students will not be following. Or in other words, what I can say, these people will follow a linear approach of learning. Okay. So you cover. Let us say I am going to draw. Let me draw a line here, and I can say that this is a linear approach, and I have different points. Okay, this is one point. This is another one. I have another one point to be discussed here, and we do have another one point to be discussed. So three points I am discussing in the class, and all the three things are connected, and all the three things are connected here. So it is linear information. So first information, after that I will move on to the second, and after that I will move on to the third. But in the case of global learners, they follow a different approach. When you teach the first point and the second one, then they will try to connect it in a different way. They will go for a different approach, and another person may take a different path. When the third one is also discussed, they will try to connect this one and the two, or one and the three, and this two and the three. So like that, they will take different paths. So that kind of learners are always called as global learners. Now these global learners will be mostly following non-linear. Okay. So in a classroom, we have this many types of learners. For a person viewing the classroom, that classroom might be a homogeneous group for that person, but for a teacher who is handling the classroom, for her or for him, the classroom is always a heterogeneous group, because you do have an assorted learners. So many types of learners are there. And we cannot say that a person is always sensory at all point of time. Sometimes the same sensory learner will become intuitive learner in some other subject. Depending upon their area of interest, they will become either intuitive learner or sensory learner, and so on. Sometimes some person will become a visual learner. In some cases, they will prefer auditory learner. They will become an auditory learner. So it is always the students will be, or the learners will be moving away from here to there and there to here, and like that it will be going. Okay. So when I am handling this thing, when I am handling the different types of learners, we need to first identify the type of learning style, and accordingly we have to address the majority of the learners. It is not that we have to address each and every individual's learning style. That is not at all possible. So majority of the type of learners, if your majority learners are coming under reflective nature, then your teaching strategy has to be different. Okay, your teaching strategy has to be different. And one another important component of your outcome-based education is, in outcome-based education, most of the time, we move towards there are different theories of learning. Let me throw some light on it, and then we will move on to the pedagogical techniques. Okay. So the theories of learning I will discuss. So the theories of education that we discuss here. Okay, there are different theories of education. So we call it as PAH. Okay, we call it as P. Second one is we have A, and then we have this H. Okay, so this should also be taken into consideration when we are dealing with the people. So what does this P stands for? P stands for pedagogy. Okay, what does this A stands for? Everybody knows that A stands for andragogy. Okay, A stands for andragogy. And what does this H stands for? H stands for pedagogy. H stands for pedagogy. So we call it as PAH continuum. PAH continuum. So in this PAH continuum, what is this P? In case of pedagogy, it will be revolving around the teacher. It will be revolving around the teacher. The teacher is the pivotal point. Okay, the teacher is a pivotal point, and the teacher will decide what is to be taught. The teacher will decide what is to be taught. Okay, what is to be taught in the classroom. So for that one only, you will be writing this instructional objective. The instructional objective. Let me not discuss this andragogy. Let me move on to the pedagogy. In the case of pedagogy, the shift will be towards, or it will, the teacher point of focus will be shifted towards learners. Here the learner is the pivotal point. Okay, here the learner is the pivotal point. So the learner will decide what is to be learned. The learner will decide what is to be learned. Okay, so here let us assume that, okay, one of you among the 100 participants, one of the participant is interested in learning the nuances of computational thinking. Okay, the nuances of computational thinking, and the teacher, they are the nuances of engineering education or whatever it may be, depending upon your interest. You will be referring to your books, you will be referring to the notes, and you will start learning by yourself. Okay, so that is what is called as pedagogy. And in the pedagogy, the learner will decide what is to be learned. The learner will be following a non-linear approach here. The learner will be following a non-linear approach, whereas in the case of pedagogy, the learner will be following a linear approach. In the case of pedagogy, the learner will be following a linear approach. Okay, because the teacher takes the classroom in a linear mode. Teacher places the classroom in a linear mode. A step-by-step methodology will be adopted by the teacher for handling the classroom. Okay, that is the most important point that we need to discuss. So depending upon the type of students, okay, depending upon the type of students, we need to decide to what percentage of pedagogy will be adopted in the class, and to what percentage of pedagogy will also be adopted in the class. There could be some instances where in some classrooms only pedagogical approaches can be adopted, but in few classrooms there could be a scope for the teacher where some pedagogical approaches can also be adopted. But before adopting this pedagogy, we need to have a picture that what is andragogy. We need to have a clear picture that what is meant by andragogy. In the case of andragogy, the point of focus will be towards both the teacher and the learner. Both the teacher and the learner will decide what is to be taught, what is to be taught, what is to be taught, and what is to be learned. So friends, if you look at this one, okay, this pedagogy, this is your pedagogy, this is your andragogy, and this one is your pedagogy, this one is your pedagogy. Literature says pedagogy is mostly meant for children. Okay, pedagogy, pediatrician, all these things is meant for children. Andragogy is for adult learners, and pedagogy is for is a learner who can learn things on their own, can learn things on their own. I will also tell you some of few of my experiences here, because we recently carried out some of the projects with the NCERT, and then you will come to know like how the different approaches that has been adapted in any classroom will make the learner move from the pedagogical approach to pedagogical approach. Okay, So let me tell you the case study here. So the case study is open this page. So the case study is we were working on a project sponsored by the Ministry of Education. So we wanted to know whether this pedagogical approach, andragogical approach and tutagogical approach can be adopted in any of the engineering sessions or any of the classroom sessions. So for that one, we approached one engineering college and in that engineering institution we wanted to do this. Okay, we experimented this. So we identified, we sought the help of the teachers, but one chemistry teacher volunteered himself to handle this content. Okay, to handle this PAH continuum. Okay, the PAH continuum in the class. Okay. So the topic given to the teacher was that the teacher was asked to identify the topic. Okay, please explain tutagogy. Okay. So tutagogy means based on the request from one button, tutagogy means, let us say, if you have it is self-determined learning. We call it as self-determined learning. It is otherwise known as self-determined learning. Say, for example, let me tell you, like one of my friend did his masters from IIT masters. But he had some kind of interest towards astrology. So he was working in Dubai, but at the same time, he did a master's in astrology he's not become an astrologer. He is now a practicing civil engineer only. But this person, on his own interest, he wanted to learn things, and that was decided by him and not by anybody. So you might be having some interest towards, let us say, Bitcoin, or you might be having some interest towards blockchain phenomena, but you might be a practicing chemical engineer, but you have a strong interest towards these domains, and you will start referring to these books and you will learn on your own. That is what is called tutagogy. In any classroom, we want the students to learn things on their own. Towards that level, we need to take the classroom. For that one, we have to ensure whether the students are following the fundamentals or not. For handling fundamentals, we will be going for pedagogical approach, because that is most vital. And for applying these fundamentals, we will be making this andragogical approach. And for making the students on their own, they will be getting some clue and they will start learning things. That is what is called as tutagogical thing. So this case study will give you some picture on what is this pedagogy, andragogy. So the teacher, we told the teacher to select the topic on their own, and the teacher told that he will select the basic topic called water. Okay, basic topic called water. Okay, right. So this was the topic. So the pedagogical approach. Imagine for engineering students, we experimented. So we thought that it was a basic topic. We do not know what the teacher is going to experiment with this topic. So the teacher told, I want all the students. So the teacher said, the frame and objective. The objective is at the end of the session. Okay, at the end of the session, the students will be able to take the formula for water. Okay, it was very rudimentary for us. So we thought that, okay, something is experimenting, let us not intervene into that. So that one we decided. Second one is, everybody wrote the formula for water, because they are all college graduates. Okay, they were college students. So they were able to give the correct formula for one. Okay. You know that it is HG. So now the teacher went into an andragogical approach. What is that andragogical approach? The teacher asked why the formula for water is written as high school O and not O high school. So this is the second. So now you see in the pedagogy, he told the students that this is how the formula for water is to be written. So everybody everybody already knew the formula. So therefore they wrote the formula at least. But now the teacher asked his students, why the formula for water is written as H2O and not O? Okay. We were also thinking, because I also know the formula for water, but I have not thought this way, because why it is not written as H2O and not O? So okay, now let me share some of the answers here. We have documented it. So one of the students told, maybe it is arranged in alphabetical order. Okay, maybe it is arranged in alphabetical order. Okay. Second one, we have, now let me ask the participants, do you have any clue here? Why the formula for water is written as H2O and not as OH? Yes? Maybe I request the participants to unmute themselves and give me the answers. Do they have any? You can unmute or you can post your answers in the chat box.
Generally, the anion is written first, and then cation.
Okay, anion is written first. Okay, followed by cation. Okay, right. Okay, right. Now we got different answers. We got different answers from the student. So one student said, okay, it is arranged in the order, descending order. In the sense, hydrogen has two atoms here, and there is only one atom of oxygen. Okay. So therefore, it is written in descending
order. Hello, sir.
Yes, madam. Yes, tell me.
Yes, it is an anion cation, and the depends upon electronegativity. So anion is written, it is cation anion. It is not anion cation. Yes. Cation is H and anion is O.
Thank you.
And
Lena.
Yes. Okay, so now let us see. I'm not looking for the correct answer, but the thing here is, the teacher's main intention is, the teacher wants the students to probe on this question and give them the kind of answer. So you see, H2O and OH2, so it is from examples to rules. Okay, they are trying to formulate rules. Why it is written like this? So some students told, it is H is having two atoms and O is having one atom, so it is written as H2O. And some students told, okay, no, in Mendeleev's periodic table, H is coming first and O is coming after H. So therefore, it is written in the order of, it is following Mendeleev's periodic table. It is arranged in the form of periodic table. So that periodic table component is being applied here. So many different answers we got here. And we were so thrilled that like one simple question was able to make the students to probe on that issue. And finally, the teacher gave the answer. I didn't record that answer, but we have recorded the answers of the students. Okay. Maybe erudite scholars here or scholarly participants can give the correct answers maybe after the lecture is over. Now that you see the different approach, then for each and everything, the teacher has to nullify this one. So the teacher gave one example. So when I take the case of ammonia, okay, where N comes first, H comes last, so this alphabetical order cannot be applied. Okay, right, so this is not applied. Then, okay, so you said that it is arranged in descending order, H2 and O1, like this, it is H2 and O, but here is N is 1 and H is 3, so this principle also not coming here, is not also applicable here, so this one has been scored out. And after that, the Mendeleev's periodic table, you said H is coming first, H is the first element in Mendeleev's periodic table. But in the case of Mendeleev's periodic table, if that principle principle is adopted in ammonia, it's got in HM, H3N, then why NH3 is coming into picture? So therefore, this principle cannot be adopted. Probably this anion-cation relationship will tell the students to come on for a correct formula for water. Okay. So this is what is called as andragogical approach. So here, both the teacher decided and the learner decided. So it was an active participation, and it is all making the students to kindle. You have to kindle the minds of the students. So when you give them some question which is going to kindle the mind of the students, then the students will be automatically working on that. And on the last day, towards the end of the session, the teacher told, okay, so now today we have discussed water. So tomorrow I request you to come out with some interesting questions on water. So anything, if you have any doubts regarding water, come out with some kind of interesting question. Of course, many students came out with some interesting questions, but one question, it was really very attractive for us. So we recorded that question. So one student came and told us the very next day, "So teacher, today when I went to my home, I could see my mother boiling some water in a pan. Okay, I could see my mother boiling some water in a pan. And after some time, I could see the gaseous state of water. After some time, I could see the water started boiling, and I could see the gaseous state of water. Okay. So my basic thing is, what should I call the gaseous state of water? Should I call the gaseous state of water as water vapor? Yeah. Should I call that one as water vapor, or should I call that one as steam? Okay, this was the question. Okay, so when I call this one as water vapor, should I call this one as water vapor, or should I call that one as steam? Okay, if I call that one as water vapor, then what is steam? Then which one should I call as steam? If I call that one as steam, then what is water vapor? Okay, so this was the question. And second one is, the student was also asking that, okay, we all know that due to sun's heat, the water bodies are getting evaporated and it is going the form of a vapor. So anything that is visible as a steam, or anything that is not visible as water vapor. So many questions, so many doubts the student has. Maybe the scholarly people can find the correct answer for that question. But our intention is, you see, the prime intention here is, we want the students to write the formula of water using the formula of water. The teacher also taught further things like balancing chemical equation of water, chemical equations here and there. But in the case of andragogy, this question kindled the mind of the students to go up to this pedagogical level. And they were pondering, like, they wanted to seek an answer for this question, and some students, they were unable to get an answer. Some students, they had a question and they gave an answer, and those answers were found to be correct answer. But this question was something like intriguing nature, and this was something which was like a very interesting question, a day-to-day thing which student asked, and we wanted to know whether it is a water vapor or steam. So in any class, in any engineering institution, or any classroom, when we are following this outcome-based education, rather than sticking on to this pedagogical components, it is always advisable to move away from pedagogy and move towards the other components. But when we go for this pedagogy, one main drawback here is the assessment becomes a problem here, because everybody will be having their own domain, or their own interest towards some particular domain, and the carrying out assessment in those domains becomes cumbersome task for the teacher. But towards this level, we need to make the students to go. But this andragogy is something, a blend of pedagogy and andragogy can always be, is always advisable in any classroom scenario. Okay, so right. So these are the things that I wanted to tell you. Now let me quickly summarize. Let me quickly share the other kind of, the pedagogical approach. So some of the pedagogical approaches which I wanted to share today is, it is the adaptive learning, adaptive teaching. So the type of learners that you know, okay, we have seen different types of learners. You have Gen Z learners, or you have digital natives, you have digital immigrants, you have different types of learners, sequential learners, global learners, intuitive learners, sensory learners. So according to the type of learners, we need to modify our teaching strategy. So that is actually called as your teaching, in the adaptive teaching learning approach. Adaptive teaching, we call that one as adaptive teaching. You can either start the class by asking a question and making the students to ponder over that question, or you can start the class by telling some rules and making the students do some examples towards that. Okay, and you can also make the students think on those examples, or you can give some irrelevant examples to the students and ensure that the students have correctly understood the concept and they are able to fit those relevant examples to the concept and are able to cull out those in the irrelevant examples. We call that one as adaptive teaching. Second one is, we have this inquiry based teaching. We have this inquiry based teaching. So in this inquiry based teaching, what is that? We always, rather than making the students to simply follow the rules, we want to make the students apply the rules. We want to make the students apply the, we want to make the students question the rules. Okay. So for this one, okay, question the rules. Okay. The thing here is, we know that, okay, when I given number, okay, well, let us say you have been given a number, okay, any number. Let us assume that I have 4812 here. I want to check whether this number is divisible by 4 or not. I want to know whether this number is divisible by 4 or not. So this is my question. So everybody says, okay, when I look at the last two digits, when the last two digits is divisible by 4, then the entire number is divisible by 4. That is the rule. Everybody knows that rule. But the question here is, why I should go for only the last two digits? Why the last two digits should be taken? Why the last, okay, why the last two digits are to be taken? Why the last two digits? In the sense, maybe the unit place digit and the tenth place digit, why it should be taken? And not the last, why the last two digits and not the last three digits or last one digit? Why alone the last two digits are being taken? So when you ask that question, then the student will be questioning that rule. Okay, why it is like this? Then they will start looking at each and every shortcut method. Like, why for three, for a number to be divisible by 3, we have a shortcut method. But why this thing should be taken into consideration? Why we are following this thing? What is the genesis behind that rule? So when we told this thing, inquiry-based approach, this inquiry-based approach automatically leads to reflective learning. But only thing is, as a teacher, you need to throw some light on that kind of approach. You need to throw some light on a different perspective, on a different angle. When you throw the light on that angle, and every student will be thinking in that different angles, and they will come out so many different types of questions, so many different types of answers. So probably you know that the answer is, you see, any number. So when I put this number, okay, when I say, if it is 24812, whether this number is divisible by 4, even in that case also it is divisible by 4. Let us remove this 2488 and I put 2999. I want to check whether this number is divisible by 4. Yes, in that case also it is divisible by 4. Okay, now the question here is, why is it so? The reason here is, let us assume that this number, it is written like this. It is 2900 plus 12. It is 2900 plus 12. In other words, what I can say, 299 into 100 plus 12. 299 into 100 plus 12. So the entire thing, so I want to divide it by 4. So I have to go for this divisibility. So in the first case, what happens? I hope many of you should be knowing this logic. The first case, irrespective of the number, okay, before the last two digits, that number is always multiplied by 100, and this 100 is always divisible by 2. So hence, whatever might be the number, if I add 1 here, then I add 3 here, irrespective of this number, then because of this 100, this entire number is divisible by 2. This entire number, by adding 0 to the top, it is divisible by 4. And you have a suffix 12 here. Only thing is, I have to bother about that 2. When that 12 is divisible by 4, or when the last two digits are divisible by 4, then I can easily come to a conclusion that the entire number can be divisible. So the entire number is always divisible. So similarly, the same thing can be applied for any same thing can be applied for any number. Okay. When I want to check whether a number is divisible by 9 or not, when I want to check whether a number is divisible by 8 or not, when I want to check whether a number is divisible by 6 or not, you do have shortcut rules. But we need to make the students realize the importance behind those rules, or the genesis, or the justification behind those rules. Blindly following the rules and making the students to blindly follow the rule, that is not the correct approach. That is not the correct approach. So here, when we go to this thing, so we should always make the students ask inquiry. We should make the students follow this thing. Okay, inquiry-based teaching. When we adopt this strategy, the students should go up to this reflective learning. But in the case of reflective learning, the students will be having so many questions to be resolved, so many questions to be addressed, and for which the student teacher should be in a position to clarify those questions. Okay. And the last one is crossover teaching. We call that one as crossover teaching. So the crossover teaching is, okay, crossover teaching is, let us say that, okay, let us say we are trying to connect the content and context here and there. Okay, we are trying to connect the content and context here and there. Let us say you want the students, you are taking the students on an industrial visit. Okay, when we are taking the students on an industrial visit, and there, when you want the students to apply the classroom scenario in the industrial scenario, we predominantly call this thing as crossover teaching. So in a real place work scenario, or in the case of internships, when the student goes for some industrial intern, or when the student goes for industrial training, we want to ensure that, well, whatever concepts that the student has learned, within the four walls, whether the student is able to apply beyond the four walls or not. That one we have to check it. Okay, so this is what is called as crossover learning. So for that one, we normally ask the students in the case of electrical engineering. So you see, we all know that, okay, current will always flow in closed circuit. This one we know. When a circuit is open, current will not flow. When a circuit is open, current will not flow. Current will always flow in a closed circuit. Now, the question here is, we wanted the students to identify how the circuit closing in the railway lines. How the circuit is closed in railway lines. Okay. So you have an electrical line, live electrical wire is being, so it is going there. And we also ask the students whether we are having an AC circuit or a DC there, or if you are one with AC, whether it is single phase or three phase. We wanted the students to check and tell, like, what kind of current or what kind of current is flowing across the overhead lines in the railway lines. Okay, so you have a pantograph, and this pantograph will be drawing this electrical energy from the live electrical wires, and it is used for propelling the electrical motors, and through which the electrical locomotive will run. Okay, it is used for propelling that one. But the question is how the circuit is getting closed. Okay, so you have a source on the top, and once again the circuit has to be closed, it has to reach there, or whether the circuit is grounded. We wanted the students to draw the electrical circuits, the equivalent circuits here, and some students came out with the correct answer, and some students were given the option of going and visiting the railway tracks and see that how, what are all the things they observe, and they want, and we wanted them to identify the reason behind those kind of metal strips here and there they find on the railway track, what is the use of it, all these things we wanted to connect it to the content, and this we call it as your crossover teaching. So friends, we have come to the end of the presentation. So let me quickly summarize the thing. So today, by 11:30, we started this session. We started the session of the basics of outcome-based education, and we realized that in order to get accreditation, this outcome-based education is in indispensable. So why do we follow this outcome-based education? Because the society has changed, the environment has changed, and we live in an information era. In the industrial era, everything was simple, but in the information era, everything is complex. And we always want the learners to be learning continuously, and they want to connect the learning that whatever is happening in the classroom. And after that, we looked at the different styles of learners. So you do have, you can broadly classify the learners based on their year of birth. Maybe people who are born after 2000 may be called as digital natives, and people born before 2000, they will be granted as digital immigrants. And we sorted out the characteristics of digital natives and digital immigrants, wherein we came to know that the digital natives are known for less patience, they are known for the parallel processing, they are known for welcoming the new technology, and they are known for their non-linear approach of learning. But this digital immigrant, we do have a sequential model, and we always take time to master some technologies. We follow, we always resist the technology. We have here, we are known for our patience. Okay. And we also had an extensive discussion towards the different types of learning styles by Felder and Silverman. So based on different process, okay, based on the different things, like see perception, input, organize, process and understand, the learners' styles were classified. And based on perception, you do have sensory and intuitive learners. Based on input, we do have visual and auditory learners. And this input is exclusively applicable for the sensory learners. And intuitive learners will be thinking. They'll be mostly thinking. Organizers, we have inductive learners and deductive learners. Inductive is examples to rules, and deductive is rules to examples. Process is active and reflective. Reflective learners are mostly questioning the rules, and active learners are mostly executing the rules. Understand is sequential and global learners. Sequential learners, they follow a linear approach, and global learners, they mostly follow non-linear approach. And using this one, we discussed a few case studies. And after that, we came across the different theories of education. We do have different theories, namely pedagogy, andragogy, and plutagogy. Pedagogy is where the teachers are dominant and they decide what is to be taught, and it is mostly linear in nature. Andragogy is where both the teachers and students or the learners will be deciding what is to be taught and what is to be learned. And it will be a blend of both pedagogy and plutagogy. And the plutagogy is something like this, mostly self-determined learning. So where the learner will be so determined to learn certain things on his own. So this learner will decide what is to be learned, and they follow this non-linear. Here, it is mostly non-linear approach, and the assessment is very cumbersome, or assessment is difficult, because everybody will be having their own area of interest. And finally, we came across the different pedagogical approaches. We do have different pedagogical approaches, namely crossover learning is there, then you have inquiry-based learning, then you have reflective learning. So, and we also had another one type of learning called as adaptive teaching. So depending upon the learners, we can adapt the teaching strategies. Whatever teaching strategies you have, you can modify the screenplay, and then if you execute it, definitely you will yield fruitful results. Okay. And once again, let me reiterate that the learners are not always fixed. The sensory learners are not always sensory learners throughout their entire life. They will move towards intuitive. They will be intuitive learners in certain aspects, and they will be sensory learners in certain aspects. And the same people might become inductive learners in certain aspects, they will become detective learners in certain aspects. The same person might become global learners in certain aspects, and they will become sequential learners in certain aspects. So it is all human being. It is very difficult to predict it, but their mindset, but based on the facial reaction, body language, as an experienced teacher, you will be able to come out, like you will be able to identify how the learner's learning style is, and accordingly, you can adopt the particular teaching style for engaging the students and for making the classroom lively. So friends, we have come to the end of the session, and now the session is open to the participants. In case if the participants are having any kind of queries or clarifications, to my level best, I will try to answer. Over to the participants and over to the coordinator.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah, we can invite one or two questions, sir. Hello, dear participants. If you have any queries, please ask to the resource person.
I think they do not have questions.
Yes, I don't think there are questions because they must be hungry for lunch.
No, yes, sir.
We will wind up our session, sir. So thanks. Thank you, Professor Giridharan, sir. So you have given a wonderful information to all the participants. Thank you very much, sir. There is a request from participants that they want your PPT, sir.
Sure, sir. I will share it, sir.
Yeah, kindly share it. Yeah.
And I will also thank Professor Rao and the authorities of NRIIT, authorities at NIIT at Chennai, and last but not the least, the participants, the dear participants, for their patient listening and the questions that they might ask. And in the meantime, I could see some feedbacks, like somebody was responding the questions that I was asking through chat window. And for those people who have responded, I express my sincere thanks and gratitude for the patient listening. Thank you all. Thank you very much for your wonderful
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.